Thank you, Vili. It's a pleasure to be here. This is 6 years. To come back to Freiburg again is a wonderful place. This is such a wonderful community, and I really appreciate the opportunity to come back. So we're going to talk about components, just a little bit about me beforehand. I come from Washington, D.C. in the United States. I started a company called 8Shapes in 2006, and that was the year I worked on my first what we now call design systems at Sun Microsystems, long live Java, anyone? Okay, anyway. And you can find me on Twitter, and in particular, I do a lot of writing on Medium, and so you'll see content like this there. If I appear a little nervous, it's not because I'm giving a talk to an in-person crowd, although it's been a couple years. It's because my dad's in the back of the audience, and I have serious, like, dad issues going on right now. So if I'm a little nervous, cut me a little bit of a slack there. And so design systems, and in particular the things we make in design systems, all start with these small little parts. You build a foundation of style, like your color, your typography, your iconography. You start to thread that through all the smallest parts, like buttons and checkboxes, inputs, and you start to make some bigger things like cards and alerts. And teams have been doing this now for years. And you start to build all those different pieces over time. And as you think about the catalog of features you're making for other people to reuse, it's going to grow and grow and grow until you might reach a threshold, a ceiling, a point when, should we still be making more stuff? Is this all there is? Like, we made button and a few other things, and I think we're done? Like, what are we supposed to do now? And so teams have been grappling with this the last few years. Should we make some more? Some other teams are, maybe we shouldn't. Some other teams are like, we're too big. We need to make fewer things. And so you start to think about, well, how big should we get? And you start to look at the different design systems out there, and everybody has their favorite, whether it's Google Material, or in the case of what you see here, IBM Carbon, or Atlassian Design, Adobe Spectrum, Shopify Polaris, Salesforce Lightning, one of the first big prominent ones around 2014 when they came out. And you look, how many do they have? Carbon, 39. Okay, we're about right there. Should we go all the way to 85 like Salesforce Lightning has? Note, they deprecate things. They can't end the life of anything. They have to permanently support everything they made across all their versions, because that's how it works at Salesforce. So be careful about how much you choose to maintain. And so you think about the journey that each of the different design systems are on. And I had the fortune to consult with Atlassian about 4 years ago now. And since then, they were at a point where they had about 26 components in their library. And they were like, we're not going to work on components for 18 months. And I was like, Alex, you are crazy. How are you not going to work for components? Like, that's what you make. And there's more to life than just components. But since then, they continue to grow. And their design system lead now, Jenny, she identified, yep, they kept asking for more. We want to serve more. And they've grown to about 50. And other design systems will find themselves on similar journeys. I started a design system at Morningstar, their United States financial services company. And in 2017, we launched with 18 things. And then in 2018, we'd added about 10 more things. And I'm indicating the things we added in green. By 2019, I had left the program, sort of handed things off to the product owner that replaced me. And they grew to 44, but some of that was cheating. Like, they had a forms category, and it just, like, they made checkbox, radio button, and all those separate pages. But you can see then 2020 and 2022, 47, and then down to 45. Some things got deprecated and ended their life. Other things were still new. But if you're someone investing in design systems, you're like, what am I paying for? Like, there's a whole team behind this, and there's still the same amount of stuff. And so when I come in and consult with teams, sometimes I'll help them do an assessment of where they're at. How are they with architecting all the features that are part of their catalog? And also, like Vitaly was explaining, how are they operating? How are they doing the work? Are they succeeding in the way that their workflows and relationships work? And one of the questions I'll ask is, how do you all feel? Do you think you need more? Do you think you need less? Do you think you need the same amount, but you need to work on them to make them better? And as actually, more often, people on the design system team will answer the second or third answer. We need the same amount or fewer things. people that are consuming the design system, I just want more. Just give me more. I want more components, make all our stuff. I don't want to have to do any work anymore. I just want to show up and say, this page is made of these things, and it just all magically gets put together. That's not how it works. There's a lot of work that each of the teams still has to do to make their experiences, but they want more. And so when you talk to design system teams, one of the reactions you'll hear is that they express caution. We don't make all the components. Like, that, our thing is not the place where all the things belong. We only work on shared needs. We think about how much it's going to cost to support it, maintain it over time. And then also, they're perfectionists. I tend to find a lot of perfectionists in design system teams where they're thinking about not just does it show up on the page and kind of look like how it's supposed to look in Storybook, but is it accessible? Is it usable? The best design system teams are asking, is it performant? And is it performant within all the other considerations of performance that you have to think about? And most design system teams are like, this isn't the only problem we solve. We need to think about documentation, whether or not it's getting adopted. How do we measure our success? Are we testing them well? Are we onboarding our customers and so on? There's a range of concern that can tamp down how many components that you want to make. And so what I want to explore today in this talk is three different questions. The first is, when you're thinking about design systems, should they make bigger components? The second question is, should we start offering smaller, more flexible things than what we actually already have? And the third thing is our place the place where all the shared things belong? And the question or the answer isn't always yes or no. So let's talk about, should we make bigger components in our system? And oh my gosh, it's so refreshing to have people from outside design systems come into design systems. I landed on a project within the last year where the product manager was new, and he had never done design systems before, and he was like, we need organisms in our design system. We've got to have them. All I see is buttons. I need more than that. And everybody that had been working on the design systems was like, slow down a little bit, okay? When you hear the word organisms, if you're not familiar with Atomic Design by Brad Frost, it's partway along the scale from small on the left, your atoms and your molecules, towards the bigger, more composed things in a particular view. Think like a hero on a page or a much more complex component. And the thing is, when that person came into the team, they're like a lot of people that don't work on design systems day to day. Their experience is making the things on the right. And so they want the design system to make the things that they see on the right-hand side, organisms, page types, et cetera, all the big stuff, because that's really their level of investment that they're making, typically in their product experience, a journey across many different pages. And they're thinking about, how do we make that one big part of that one page more performant? And so as you think about their expectations, I'm going to challenge you throughout this talk to change your expectations on what you're getting out of a design systems, and are organisms the right place to be? James, my teammate, said organisms are always, as a consultant, an uncomfortable joke that we always have to talk through, because can you make that really big thing when it doesn't yet have all the smaller things inside it already available in the system? And so let's take an example. Obviously more abstract, but we don't need detailed user interface to have this conversation. A filter, in particular a filter drawer. Imagine you're working with a data table, and out from the right-hand side of your desktop app, you see this panel that's or you could call it a drawer, that has a bunch of checkboxes for you to filter, let's say, a list of accounts, if you're looking at your bank accounts or your investments or something like that. And you've established the filter, you make it go away, and you continue working on your data table. And so as a design system professional, the first thing you do when somebody says, we need filters in our system, you start looking at other systems. IBM Carbon has a pattern for it. Morningstar has a pattern for it. Shopify, Polaris, and Google have portions of their componentry that talk about filters. And you start to do the research, and you start to realize, like in your company, when people say the word filter, they actually mean a lot of different things. It might be a drawer that comes out from the left-hand side. It might be a column within the page. It might just be a little search box at the top that you type, and it gives you a combo box that then, every time you match a certain criteria, it just adds it as a little pill. But it's always just above the content. It's really lean. And then you start to look at the details of those things, and you realize even those behaviors of filtering might be the same, but the actual interface components can be quite different. And so when they want this filter, what actually do you need to make? Who's going to make it? And where are you going to go to get it so that you can reuse it? And so, fortunately, your design system is got the basics. When you look at this, you look at the green parts, you're like, yeah, we've got some typography, we have buttons, we have checkboxes, we have icon buttons so that we can make the X and the full screen dismissal icon on the upper right. But like, what are all the things we don't have that are smaller than the filter? It's a drawer. It has a search field. It has checkbox that are nested. It has a drawer to essentially open and close those nested portions of checkboxes. It has a full screen toggle that is apparently going to show you a full modal of all the options. Maybe it's going to show you even more stuff to filter. And oh, by the way, it needs to be responsive. And so when I see a design as a person driving a design system, I'm looking for all the orange stuff, because that's the uncomfortable middle that the people don't realize, that when they ask for those things, you're asking for six more components and a responsive design that's going to work on the way you've built your page responsively, as opposed to the way that team and that team and that team built their pages responsively. And so each of these things comes with a cost, in particular the drawer and its complexities actually can be quite expensive. The responsive design can take a lot of time to work through. And then I'm also thinking about, what's the shared need of this thing? If we only built a drawer, is there a shared need? And actually, there's a moderate shared need in a lot of companies. They can use that drawer for a filter. They can use it for notifications. They can use it for settings. They can use it for other things. And so suddenly, I'm breaking down the design to identify where's the biggest bang for our buck, and should we build any or all of these things? The other thing that I think about is, what's the shared need of this thing? And from top to bottom, you'll see five different things. And you know, I'm a design systems professional, so obviously everybody in the organization, every team, if you look at the bottom axis, is what proportion of teams in your enterprise need this thing. Everybody needs the design system, right? Like, you're going to make me really uncomfortable if you say some people don't need the design system. But like, everybody needs a design system. And actually, at this particular company, greater than 50% of them need some sort of filter pattern. But how about filter as a drawer? And less than 50%. How about filter as a drawer with those nested multi-selection checkboxes? Even fewer. How about the account filter built as a drawer, integrated with your back end? Now we're talking to somebody who wanted to have something in the system that's only relevant to what? 12% of the teams that are going to adopt this thing? You're not thinking through this completely. It's not just about shared need. It's about shared use. How many of those teams that need this thing are going to use this thing, let's say within 12 months, some arbitrary amount of time? And now suddenly, I've got three teams that need to use this filter drawer that is four accounts integrated with the back end. I immediately go down to their ask, which is the bottom left corner, that tiny little green bar. And when I'm thinking about serving the wide shared needs of everybody, I'm less inclined to do it. But design systems have made a lot of the small parts now, and so they're starting to consider building more of these things, going from top to bottom, from right to left, to build them. And so then you need to talk about, okay, if we're going to build this, who's going to do the work? There are a lot of steps to complete to build a component or a pattern. You start with discovery, you do some design, and then you do the specs, and then there's still some more design stuff to do, the production of Figma assets and documentation, and you produce the code. And fortunately, lots of times a designer will say, we're building the account filter. I totally want to add this to the design system. What are you going to do? I'll do the discovery design, and I'll make the Figma thing, right? That's all the stuff we need. No, what about the specs, the design docs? And once it's in there, the developers are going to expect to have a commensurate code capability, too. And so who's going to do those things? And often, with particularly the bigger things, you're having a designer or an engineer come to you with this kind of promise. And so it's incomplete what they're going to deliver, and you have to think about the consequences of that and whether the design system is going to fill in the blanks for them. And so one team I worked with, I coached them for about half a year. They were at this point where they had made enough components, and they were like, we're going to try this out. We're going to make a filter. It's broadly needed across our enterprise. We as a core team, we're going to make it. We're going to integrate it into the back end, because fortunately, and they had about 50 teams in their organization, and about 30 of them were going to use this. 30% of them were going to use this. So that's a non-trivial, that's like 15 teams in their organization. And they built it, and it worked. Widespread adoption, consistent experiences, And just as much as creating the business value of having the feature, they learned from that. And they said, actually, there might be something to this, building these bigger parts. And so let's try it again. Let's do the data table. Almost everybody needs the data table. And they actually built one, and it's adopted in 50% of the repositories. Great investment. Another one, too. OK, let's do the calendar. Nobody wanted to use the calendar. The shared need wasn't there. It was really hard to integrate into the teams. And it left the core team feeling really dissatisfied. So as opposed to building up speed, they had started to slow down. They felt like it was a bad investment. And so as you think about all the different bigger things that you could add to your design system, keep these in mind, these dimensions of shared need, cost, maintenance. And what's good for you might not be good for somebody else. And so I've had two teams I've consulted with. The first team I was just telling the other stories about, they built an editor too, like a little text editor at mentioning some other features within the box and the toolbars that surround it. Nobody used it. Bad investment. And so they really started to screech to a halt with all of their bigger organism work. The data table, great. The filter, great. And then it wasn't much more for them to do. At Atlassian Design System 2, if you go to Atlas Kit, where their code is at, it's an entirely community-driven component. And I think it has 172 breaking changes in the last 5 years or so. It's amazing how fast they are breaking that. And it's pervasively used across a lot of their products, which blows people's mind. Like, when you're talking about design systems, you're like, we're going to do one breaking change every 2 years, because otherwise everybody's going to like throw stuff at us. We have to be really stable and deliberate. But the dev community is like, no, we're going to leave that behind. 8 versions of button? How about 172 versions of our editor? Thanks very much. We got this. The uncomfortable thing was, how does it fit within their documentation? You won't find the editor in their core design, like their core site that you go, design.atlassian.com. But you will find it in Atlas Kit, because it's still something that's a very valuable asset to them. So as you think about organisms, they have to serve a shared need. Most of the time, encourage people to build them locally and then think about promotion, or building them systematically in that place to think about promotion. You're going to want to demonstrate them. A lot of design systems don't yet have a place for patterns, or a place for templates, or a place of a reference or demo application. They just offer the small parts without showing you how they get put together. And be wary, because if you go organisms, the priorities of the people that make them, if they're contributed, won't necessarily be to maintain them for all the other teams that they don't get incentives to build for. And so you have to be really wary about supporting it. Second question, should we build smaller, flexible components and offer them through our design system? Oftentimes, the conversation is, some system user, engineer, designer, who cares? They speak a similar language. I need something for my product. And what they're really saying is, I want something from your system. And then you answer, great, let's add a property, right? We're getting pretty good at this, right? Building things incrementally. Engineers on one side and designers on the other now have tools like, let's say, React and Figma that both can start to increasingly conform to the same anatomy of how something's built and the same properties of how you configure it. And so as you combine those two things and you start to see that synthesis across design and engineering assets, you start to have very predictable outcomes for a component like a card. You can create all these different displays of different image sizes, different types of content, like a piece of metadata above the title or a description below the title, different coloring mechanisms, and even the ability to put in some custom content. And so once you get a configurable card, you've solved a lot of problems. Imagine you've solved 75% of the cards. And so more cards come up. People love cards. They want to start to reuse them and make them in different ways, whether they want to reverse the order of the image and the content, or they want to put a label above the title with a pill, or they want to make it horizontal in nature, or they want to, in the upper right-hand corner, add a little X to dismiss it. Wait, where are my options for that? I don't have any of those options. What am I supposed to do now? Like, am I allowed to do this? Can I make these things? And the answer is, no, you can't make any of these things. Those are all invalid cards. Sorry, go away. Like, our card's done. It's configurable. We don't have time for that. Like, we'll put that in our backlog. Maybe we put it in our backlog? Is that stuff that we should start to support with our card? Because those are a lot of robust configurations, and the card is that component right between molecule and organism that's going to make you uncomfortable about what you're doing with your system. And so the first thing you could do is add a bunch of alternatives. Maybe we add the image property that is really, maybe that's better, image location above or below. Maybe we add an orientation, horizontal or vertical, and then your image location should be first or last, not above or below. And so you can imagine, look at all these properties. Like, really, we're going to add like 7 properties or 6 properties to this thing? It's just going to keep growing and growing with every different request. Or you could just say, we're out. Like, we offer you a bunch of the small things. Go ahead and create all your frames. Add some icon buttons. Color it all yourself. Use hex values. Don't even use design tokens. We don't care. Like, just make it work. That's obviously a terrible response, right? That's not good. Or you could put it together with smaller parts. Maybe you need to think about the card that you have and start to break it down into smaller things, like a chunk that corresponds to the text that they can independently configure and put where they want or compose where they want. And so these are the conversations around subcomponents that a lot of the teams I'm consulting with are having in this past year. Past 12 to 18 months, everyone wants to break down the card. They want to break down their header. They want to break down their lists, vertical list navigations that has highlights and icons and so on. So there's a number of components that are common in this kind of venture where you want to take something like a card and divide it into smaller parts that are really still only intended to be used in that component itself. So let's break it down. You look at a card, you have all the different pieces, and you're thinking about the spatial models between the image and then all the different types of content that are going to go in there. And the way my mind, like whenever I see a design, I'm immediately drawing rectangles around it. Different types of rectangles. Okay, that box with that red boundary is where all three of those consistent, configurable metadata, title, and description are, got it. And then I'm realizing I actually am breaking it down into two types of things. There are parts that I want to reuse and move around and customize, and there are the containers, the different zones at different levels of hierarchy that I want to put them in. And so, for example, with a card, it might be a container and then a smaller portion for the content that I want to have things like media, text, and actions in. And they're all built specifically for making cards. And so I'm going to walk you through the different kinds of subcomponents that I've encountered. And one of them is lockups, particularly lockups of multiple pieces of text. Why? Because there are a lot of properties that go with these lockups, not just color modes and dark and light, but also size, if you need small, medium, or large interfaces in terms of the density and size that you have. And also the appearance or lack thereof of some of them, particularly metadata and description, but also the space. Space is so hard for people. Like, how many, if you know what design tokens are, they're like little variables that describe your visual language. People have like thousands of color tokens, and then you look at their space tokens and you're like, there's 6 things here. There's like a basic scale. What are you doing? Like, there's no value, meaningful value here. Anyway. I'm going off on a tangent. The fact is that space is actually a complicated thing for people to implement. And when you create these smaller components, embedding the space has a significant value. It saves them time and creates consistency. The next type is extensions, and this is a pretty basic example of, imagine the image that you want to use in card. You might have an image component that you extend or even create what in design computing patterns is called a facade of limiting what they have access to of the image, which might provide robust capabilities, and instead just say, for cards, here are the 3 aspect ratios we want you to be able to use. But it's still easy. It's the card image, and there's pretty much not a lot of thinking to implementing with it. Another thing teams are doing is creating closed sets or combinations of elements that are relevant to putting cards, whether you want 1 button, 2 buttons, or even 2 buttons that have some hierarchy with them. And so here's an example of just the Figma component you would see with it. But notice there aren't the 3rd and 4th types of buttons. There aren't icon buttons necessarily. And so there's a bit of governing going on with that as well. And then also just repeaters. We've already been doing subcomponents for a while. People have checkboxes in a list. They just don't realize that they are creating this hierarchy of components that enable people to compose with things. In addition, there's the kinds of containers, and one of them is just the overall shape container. And even there, you start to, when you take a component and you disperse all of its properties to many of the subcomponents, there's a lot of things at the top level, the color modes, the variants, And also, oftentimes, if it's the same thing, the states of the overall component, because it's the card itself that you can tap on. So it's going to have a focus state. It's going to have a press state. It's going to have other things like that. And then that is something that you build outside in. And so you just put whatever children you want into it, and guess what? You're off to the races to make the card of your choice. Another one is zones within that. So like a container, not the card overall, but the space into which you might put media. If you don't have a card media component that handles all the cases, maybe you just make a card media container, and into that they could put a spot illustration, an icon, an image, maybe even a video. And so that too creates significantly more flexibility, and it puts the control in the author's hand. And additionally, at the bottom, the last one is interactive. You start to think about with composition, they are going to have to wire up some interactions. And it's okay to have multiple interactions in a card. So how can you have one zone that's the primary interaction and other zones that they just put their own icon buttons in there because they want to and that's the solution they need? And so all these questions pop up, and like you really get revved up. Like I feel like a kid again. Like I get revved up, and I'm just going to take this thing for a spin and make my own card and think about behaviors, layout and spacing questions. Am I going to put the padding in there? I'm going to leave the padding out of there. There's a lot of complexity, but you want to put the control in the hands of your composers, all the teams using cards so that they can reorder it, they can reorient it, they can add their own behaviors, they can customize their action. All these things that used to be can'ts turn into cans, and you enable them to succeed. And so this feels flexible to them. It's increasing and empowering them to innovate and experiment, and it unblocks them. Suddenly, instead of, I want to make my card horizontal, and the design system saying, great, we'll get that done in 4 months, we think. It might be 7 months. Is that okay? And they're like, no, I want to do it right now. So you unblock them with something that they have a little bit of work to do. And so there are things you should anticipate. The more you make things smaller and flexible, the more the system team is going to go, whoa, we are totally out of control here, and they're going to make inconsistent things, and I don't trust them at all. They all stink. They don't say that directly. But their behaviors for people that work on design systems sometimes imply a lack of trust in the capability of people using the system. And I try to bend that around. Like, I try to say, maybe your tools are too hard. Maybe you need to work harder to create better examples, because there is going to be more work for them. This is going to be something they are creating that's more custom, but they're meeting the business need faster, and I'm all for it. Even if the tools are a little bit awkward for them or they have to learn it, I think the performance, you can't optimize all those small parts once they put them together. That's something they're going to have to figure out. And that is a trade-off they're going to have to decide to make for themselves or not. But if they need a horizontal card, they're going to make a horizontal card. So how can you make it easier for them? And so when you think about the principles, do you want to, up to now, especially with this explosion of Figma and all the properties and variants and stuff that designers are now architecting things to, which is great. The mindset has been make the very common things configurable, and then over time, make the less common things configurable as you have time to do it. I think you need to change your mindset and put something in the middle. And before you start chasing properties, you need to start thinking about enabling them to compose things themselves with greater and greater flexibility. The last thing I wanted to talk about is the design system the place for shared components, particularly the components that they aren't making as a part of what many teams call their core? Other users, whether it's a designer or an engineer, will say, I have something I want to share. And they're implicitly saying, I think other people need this. And then you say, great, let's add it. Maybe, like, do other people actually need this? I'm not so sure. But let's provide a place to for that to happen. And people's mental model of design systems is it's the one source of truth. It's singular. It's central. It's perfect. It's in the middle, and all the other teams use it. There's one place. And I'm tired of that being one place, because there are many places that systematic work is happening, and that includes on a local team. You go out in the periphery, and you have a team doing the good work to make their features, and they're making it one fix, enhancement, and design feature at a time. And as a result, they're big enough. They have lots of Figma files. They have lots of code. They're going to start creating their own systematic stuff as a library that's local. They're meeting their own unique needs. They're supporting their own team. And so they're building their own system, and is a design system there to help them. In general, the mindset will shift over time from a core kit made by a central team to shared kits made by the federated masses. And so that starts to make clear that it's not just the local and the core, but there might be more to the story. And so I go back to the, I started writing these articles on Medium like in 2015, and I wrote this article where I talked about, have this model where one solitary person makes a thing, puts it out in the middle, and everybody else is like, I don't need that thing. And so there's a second model where you have a central team, they understand the needs of all the other teams, and they make the core catalog. And then there's the third thing, the federated community of contributors, where we're all making the things and putting them in the middle. And this model has really confused people. A lot of people talk about central versus the core. And when I come into a new design system location, new client, I'll say, like, what's your model for this? And everyone's like, always, right off the tip of their tongue, we want a federated system. We want everybody to be contributing to the design system. And then I look around, or I look behind me at my past, my experience, and it turns out, wow, all those design systems are 98% made by a core team. And so that's the wrong mental model. Stop positioning or framing it as one central or two federated the other. Instead, all design systems start with architects in the middle making a core catalog that you build from, and then you gradually build the federated community from there. And as you build it, you need to provide a shared space for them to build too that is distinct from the core. It's really in between their local work and the core that's in the middle. And as you think about that, we've all started to think about that. There's a number of articles out there. I wrote one a few years ago. Spotify's written another article. Recently, Robin Cannon from IBM Carbon wrote another model. It's all getting at the same thing, that there are shared needs closer or further from the design system conceptually, and the design system may be a space for that work to happen. And so whereas a design system team may be very comfortable working on the left-hand side of this picture where they have their tokens, those tokens are woven through UI components so that they can create some themes of all their core stuff. But look at all those other things on the right-hand side. That the system is now not the make, the system team is not the maker of those things. It's just the platform for those things. Whether it's Atlassian's editor component or a charts library or a search UI, or if it's actually kits that serve other platforms at enterprises, sometimes it's Android, iOS, maybe even TV platforms like Apple TV. Or it's a CMS kit that really just builds a bunch of content components on top of your components. There's so many different things. And these shared libraries are now starting to really emerge, and teams are having to think about them. And if you have a design system, ask for the darker blue stuff. Like, how do we create this? And what are we even going to call this little orange library that's in between the core that a bunch of teams are going to work on? I've worked on a number, and nobody can agree on what this like middle layer is called. I prefer shared library because it's still embracing the fact that it's serving a shared need, but some teams love the flavor of expansion packs. Like if they're in the video game industry, like their downloadable content, whatever it is. But expansion packs is another one that gets people the most excited. I discourage you from including words like the product component library, because that immediately narrows people's mental models to, that's not for me, that's for them, because that's their product. And so as you think about where does it go, put them right next to your stuff. Oh my gosh. Make it all available in a central place so that you change from being a maker to being a curator of those items. And that warps design system professionals' models, because all they want to do is make components all day because it's fun. I love it. But suddenly, you're now, instead of making a product, you're making a service, and the kinds of things that you do change. And so core teams that really love being out in the community identify people that sometimes are referred to as stewards. And those stewards work with an identified maintainer of that shared library, one of those Figma files, one of those areas of a code repo. Maybe there's a second maintainer. Very rarely, there are other contributors to it. Usually, the conversation is with one or two other people that are going to make an editor kit or a search kit or an onboarding kit. And so how do you work with them? First, you have to name them, establish the relationship, and then you go through a process. You set up the library. You don't need to read the details. You'll find the presentation somewhere else. You set it up, you do some planning with them, and then those green check marks are, then the contributors are off to the races. They can do all that stuff themselves, except you have to also be open or revealing at the beginning that there's work to do to make this have a sufficient amount of quality. You're going to have review cycles. You're going to publish with deliberate intent, not just willy-nilly and changing things constantly. And you're going to monitor and maintain it. You might have to upgrade it from time to time. And those are responsibilities that the shared kit makers are going to have to be aware of when they make the commitment to put that thing in the place with the system. And so that embraces this sense of try to favor community and trust of your users over command and control. Like these subcomponents, these shared kits, even these organisms, they are out there as professionals too, and you're there to enable them, not to make everything for them. And so if you liked content like this, you can find my Medium channel. There's lots of writing there, but I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much. And
thank you so much, Nathan. It's going to be a cozy little conversation. So there are many questions that came up. Now, what a wonderful session. Oh, I sit in a cat. That feels weird. Thank you so much for the wonderful session. You know, it's interesting. Every time I think about the design systems now, I have a feeling like in the beginning, it was all simple. You have your little pattern library or style guide. And then you have a little set of components. And just, you know, speed, you know, go really, really quickly. And then a few years later, we need a design systems architect that manages a federated and central system and kind of thinks about how is it going to work and all. At which point do you think we actually definitely need a design system? How do you know? It seems like a lot of work.
I think there's a transition point. I think if you have one product and it's just one team making some startup product, I hope you're designing and building systematically. And it becomes that there's a tipping point after which there's enough people sharing enough stuff that you need to start to build the infrastructure around sharing it and identifying responsibilities for it. And so that could be as few as 3 or 5 teams. And then you start to see someone that has as a part-time job, they're going to manage the Figma library, or they're going to manage the shared space of code where we have all of our utilities and basic components. And really, it's around 10 to 20 teams when it becomes you really start to invest specifically in a team to do the work. I'm a little biased because most of the orgs I go in have 50 or 100 or 200 teams making digital products. But there's that threshold between 5 and 10 that I see the behaviors change.
Okay. By the way, I have plenty of questions. But of course, if you look at your badge and you go to the Google Doc, you can also bring in your questions. And so we can bring them in here. That goes, of course, for wonderful internet people who are watching us online. We love your questions, of course, as well. Another thing that actually also came up, I think, in a conversation here is how can you measure whether how you're doing in a design system? Are there like KPIs, design system KPIs, where you can really track it over time? And how can you establish it in an organization?
That's a great question. Most teams do that really poorly, if at all. I will put a link to a great, Jan Thoman put together a great list of all the articles, and I'll add a link in the Google Doc where this question is. But I'll just summarize to say, you have to think about what is success. And immediately you start to think about the two keywords that people say. Are we more consistent? Good luck measuring that. Because consistency is
really
way too complicated with things that aren't just the design system. And are we more efficient? And most often, I've seen the success on efficiency be a controlled study so that you have numbers to prove how much faster it was to build something, or estimates that are based on some financial model that people in finance, like, they nod their head yes. Like, when you create a basic math expression, it's like basic algebra from when you're 10 years old. But they say, yeah, that's good enough for me. $10 million, got it. The other things that you want to measure that teams get really good at are definitely coverage of your system. There are automated ways, both in Figma as well as code utilities that scan your repositories to see where the system is, to see what version it is, to see how often it's changing or being upgraded. And those are automated into reports. Most design systems that are investing heavily will have that kind of coverage utility. And then I'd also encourage you to think about satisfaction. Some teams use NPS score or SUS scores or other kinds of things, and they routinely, in a longitudinal way, assess whether their customers using the system are satisfied with it. And that's a great way to also give them an opportunity to identify where it's broken or challenging, and you can improve
it. Right. I really like the fact that you have this really strong alignment between how you call components in Figma, how you call it in Storybook, how you call it in code, and all of that. So do you think that at this point we kind of figured out how this, you know, $1 billion question, the bridge between the design and development for a design system, is it done? Or do you think like we're, because like this handoff, like many people are still talking about handoff when you kind of have your design phase and you're handing it over, you forget about it and you move on to the next project. And then there is a disconnect because, you know, sometimes developers have questions about design, designers have opinions about development, and it kind of goes back and forth. Would you say that we are kind of getting to this point where we say, okay, these are the components we're having, this is what they're called, we have this perfect alignment between different teams, and kind of having this naming conventions between whatever tools we're using, helping them? Or do we need extra tools to make it work?
I think the tools capabilities, particularly the designer tools becoming more powerful, are giving designers more of a voice, and you see now the design and the engineering side creating more sophisticated moments in their process. The most notable is the handoff. If you remember me talking about design or discovery, design, and spec, right during that spec process, some teams are using the spec to form essentially an agreement between designers and devs, what the properties are going to be, what the elements are going to be called. You see very clear specs, and I can link to an example in there, sure. But of specifications that have an anatomy section, specification that have a property section, and you see the agreement forming there. Others are taking it to the next step. If you use a Google Sheet or an Airtable, a lot of teams will create very sophisticated structures to audit their entire library, look for consistency and model naming, and they'll go from there, and they'll actually change. They'll do that with a major release of the system to unify all those things across components. It actually is really good, not just for the designer and engineer, but just for all the items in the catalog to be synchronized, because if they're made by different people, they often diverge in their APIs.
Just two more questions before we wrap up for now. When you talk to clients about organisms, do you explain that they are made of molecules, or is this reserved for the dev team since the client might never experience the smaller elements?
I tend to, with all due respect to Brad Frost, I tend to avoid using the atomic model because of its fixed levels. And the thing that I try, I think it's great as an opening conversation to help people appreciate the hierarchy. It's been an essential tool for our community. But I try to help them understand components contain components contain components, that there's a hierarchy of that, and that there are the concept of dependencies, and the fact that if you're going to change a smaller thing, it's going to impact the bigger thing, and so on. And so helping people learn about that nested hierarchy and the relationships between components, the word organism starts to fade away, and it really starts to say, okay, it's a component, it's going to be a package, and this package depends on these other packages.
Right.
Kind of thing. I try to bring them into that.
Oh, interesting. The last one here for now. Breaking up components into subcomponents. Could this be a risk of creating a lot of redundant properties like color mode that would be defined in every subcomponent but is the same value for each?
100%, yes, that's a risk. That is potentially code that you have essentially at multiple levels. You have to do something that in a perfect world, just the top level component's going to control. And so you have to be pretty limited. That example that you saw is a really good one around the color mechanisms, but it's kind of hard to avoid if you have things at multiple levels that are applying code at each of those levels. It's not the driest thing. Like you're going to have, it's going to smell at times, and you'll have to make a good balance of the trade-offs. Right. To make good choices there.
Cool. Maybe the last one from my end. I'm just curious at this point. So you've been working on so many different design system related projects. Is there like a dream project that you ever wished you could work on? Like something that's really complicated, something that's, I don't know, different? Anything? Is there like a dream project on your wish list that you would love to work on one day?
Yes, charts and data visualization. I have a master's degree in statistics, and I went to work for a statistics software company. And I've worked at Morningstar and other places that have chart libraries, and I've never been able to work on them. So
I
want to do
it. If you are working on or interested in some sort of a design system consultancy, maybe on anything that's charts or whatever related, you know where to go.
That's my dream.
If you have more questions, we also have a dedicated area next to the Smashing Book Stand, so you can go directly. I mean, not online, but you here can go directly there, and maybe Nathan can answer your questions as well. Right. So thank you so much for being here with us, Nathan.
Thank
it's been
so
a pleasure.
Much. Thank you. Thank you.